Next talk is about Haskell and Debian, going to be done by Joachim Breitner. He's been doing loads of stuff with Haskell, I guess, since quite a while.
Since 2007.
2007. So that's quite interesting, I suppose. So please welcome Joachim Breitner.
Thank you. First of all, this is not going to be a Haskell tutorial. I know a few people want to have that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do my talk, and if there's time at the end, which I have no idea about whether there will be time at the end because I haven't tested it yet, I'm happy to answer any questions about Haskell itself. Yeah, but still, as an introduction, what is Haskell? Haskell is a programming language. It has certain features not found in other languages, and if you list all the buzzwords of language development, they are there. It's a functional language. It's pure. That has it means it has no side effects, which makes it easier to write bug-free code. It has lazy evaluation, which means that data structures are only evaluated when they are needed, and else not. It is strongly typed, but with type inference, so you don't have to type the types, which makes the name probably a bit wrong. It can be interpreted or compiled, so you can get properly compiled binaries that you don't actually see that they are Haskell programs anymore, unless you know how to look. And it has a large number of libraries available, and this is basically the topic of the talk. We want to have all the good libraries of that in Debian available to our users. And we have been doing that for a while, and I want to share how to do it. And last of all, Haskell is fun to program in. You don't have there are a lot of things you don't have to worry about that you have in other languages. And those things that you have to worry about in Haskell that you don't have to worry about in other languages are more fun to resolve. This talk addresses you especially if you either want to use Haskell on Debian, so that you know how to use the Haskell packages for Debian and where to look for them and how to use them. That's of course also useful if you maintain a package that uses Haskell, some program. Then if you want to maintain libraries of Haskell in Debian, then this is the most important thing I'm going to talk about. If you want to do that, you are very much encouraged to join the Debian Haskell group, which is a packaging team, as many other packaging teams before. And I really discourage people to not join the group when maintaining Haskell libraries, because we tend to do changes that need to affect every library in Haskell, every Haskell library in Debian. And we are happy to do this across our repositories. If you don't have your package in our repository, it's up to you to do the changes yourself, and that only causes additional work and friction. So feel free to join the group, especially if you're a DD, because you always need people that are uploading the stuff people are building. Yeah, and then the last audience, I don't know if anybody's here from that group, are those that don't actually want to know about Haskell, but have to, because they want to release a Debian release, or want to get testing migrated, or do some QA. And I guess it helps for them, too, to understand how Debian Haskell packages work. All right. Now, Haskell code is organized in some certain way. And the lowest unit of the smallest unit of organization is Haskell modules. They have names. The names are hierarchically organized and can be either short or rather long. Then a bunch of those such modules that belong together are distributed as a package. And we have lots of packages here, so the confusion. There are Haskell packages, as in the package the upstream provides, and then there's a Debian package that we build out of it. I hope you won't get too confused. If you are, just interrupt me. These packages have names like this. There's even a Debian package in the Haskell repository that we have packaged for Debian. So there's a Haskell Debian package in Debian, or whatever. Okay, so a quick look how this might look. This useful page, which is generated as soon as you install the GHC doc package, which lists all the modules that you have installed using Debian packages of Haskell libraries on one nice page. And you can see that there are lots of modules on the left, and you can see what package they come from, as in Haskell package, and you even have an index that ranges over all the Haskell libraries installed on your system, which is a very great feature if you want to develop stuff. You have only one page to look at to find your documentation. I don't know how many other languages provide that. Anybody standing up for his favorite language? No, good. Then there's the ghg-package, pkg binary, which maintains a local repository, local registry of installed packages. In that sense, it's kind of similar to dpkg. Not exactly, but similar. And we can have a look at this. It's, for example, we can list what packages we have installed, and we find that in the system-wide location, we have these packages installed. It's quite a few. And then in the local locally also installed as a user, a few packages. They are separately from the system. And they are there. So this is the GHC view of what packages are installed. And the Debian packages, of course, make sure that when you install a Debian package of a Haskell library, the library gets registered within the system and unregistered when you remove the package again. Then Cabal specifies the source package format of upstream Haskell packages. And we will later see how that looks like. It's declarative. It has one file, a .cabal file, which describes what dependencies this package has, what C libraries it needs, a description, a license, license file, the list of modules in the package, and then it builds the Haskell libraries. And this is great for us because all the 200-something Haskell packages we have in Debian and all the thousands of Haskell packages we have not in Debian, they all build more or less the same way, which makes maintenance of hundreds of packages doable. It's a lesson we have learned since the days of the Perl team. And it's, yeah, it's good to have that. Now, for additional confusion, there's Cabal install, which is a binary. The binary is called Cabal. So Cabal can either be the source format package and library associated with that, or the binary, which comes from the Cabal install package. Great, but that wasn't my fault. Cabal install is a bit like cPAN for Perl. It can download your packages, build and install them, and it can resolve dependencies. So the locally installed packages you've seen on the shell before, I've installed them with Cabal install. And then the last important bit for the ecosystem here is Hackage, which is the Haskell package, hence the name, repository. So in a way, it corresponds to our FTP master or also to cPAN, as in cPAN, the web page. OK, at this point, I planned a demonstration. So let's assume we want to program something involving a very efficient representation of bitmaps, as in mapping numbers to bits. So in that case, I would maybe first go to the package web page, which is this. And usually, I don't look at the first page, but go directly to packages. And you see there's a lot of categories, and then there's even more packages below. And I want something that has somehow related to bit arrays. Yes. Is that better? Even more? OK. So I'm looking for bit arrays. And there's a library called bitarray. So I can look at the description. It's experimental, but people tend to name stuff when they release it first. And if it works fine, they just leave it like this. It's building on the current GHC that we also have in Debian. It's a good sign that the package is in a good shape. And it has three modules. I can also look at the API. And I see, okay, there's a data type, bit array. A packed bit array, internally, it is represented as an unboxed array of word 64s. Sounds like what I need. So let's try to get it on my machine. Now, leaving Debian out of the picture for now, I would go to the shell. I would use kabal install bit array. And it will download the package. In this case, it doesn't download it because it has been downloaded before. It is doing something about it's building it. It's doing something about documentation. It's updating documentation index. So there's basically a copy of the page I just showed you that not only includes the system-wide packages, but also the ones you've locally installed. So even those are in the index. And because I have many packages installed, it takes a while. And it's finished. And I can run ghg package list, and I will find that at the very end, there's a bit array package locally installed. And now I can see if I can use it. It's from which function did I want to test? It looks like I need documentation. List bit array. Let's see if this works. 1 to 10. True. True. False. True. Okay. Looks like it has created a data structure. It's serializing it as text in this way, and I can also do lookups, and I forgot how to do them. Lookup bit. That's fairly easy. Okay, looks like it's working. So this is how I get new code on my machine to develop with. Now, from a kabal package to a Debian package, we first have to find a consistent naming. So the general idea is that if you have a kabal package that's called bitarray, the source package name associated with this is called Haskell bitarray, which is not completely enforced. We have a few packages that derive from this, but the source package is not very important in that respect. And then we have three packages, three binary packages, that are all named after the scheme libghc, dash kabal name, dash type of the package. And we have three kinds of packages. The first one is the dev package, which is the one you need to program with. Then the documentation is separate, in case you're low on disk space, or for the build teams. And then the profiling package, which you need if you want to build a binary that has profiling enabled. Then you need the profiling packages of all dependencies. And because these also tend to be not very small, we've separated them out because not everybody needs them. Kabal install, as I said, can be used on Debian. One disadvantage of using it over the Debian packages is if something changes in the dependencies, you manually have to recompile your locally installed packages. Whereas if you use the Debian packages, this is being taken care of for you. And we will see more about that later. Again, demonstration. Oh, yeah. Now we want to have this bit array package in Debian. Because it's useful, I've used it last week to implement the setPrintNay tool. So I want to have it in Debian. I can use kabal to get the source. No. I think I'm skipping the demonstration. Yeah, packaging completer. I just wanted to show the... I'm confused. Sorry. I wanted to show the Debian packaging stuff. So a package that's already in Debian, for example, would be xmonad. So we can search for xmonad. And we see that we have these packages. They always come in three of a kind. So here they are. And there's the doc packages up there. The GHC6 are transitional packages from earlier times when we had the version number of the compiler encoded in it. So if I want to install a package and I think it might be available in Debian, I can just do, for example, xhtml, it's a Caval package, and then sounds very similar. I can just install this. I think I should have removed some package before demonstrating this. Well, it's obviously already installed, and afterwards I can see it in the global list. So there's xhtml available for Haskell to use. All right, back to the slides. Haskell package dependencies. Now, the problem with Haskell from a distribution point of view is it provides zero ABI stability. So a minor change to a package, even a change that doesn't obviously change the interface, might change the ABI. So for those who maintain C libraries, it would be as if you had a SO name bump with every upstream release and every change you might make. And obviously, treating this the same way as we do in C libraries, as in package renames and transitions and stuff, would not scale. So what we use is that GHC package already hashes the ABI. So it looks at all the things that are part of the ABI, creates an MD5 sum of that, and registers this together with the package in the database. And also, it marks for each dependency against which particular version of the ABI, which hash this has been built against. So for example, the bitarray package we've just installed, has an ID, and it consists of the cabal name, the version, and then this hash. And if I would build another package based on bitarray, this hash would be stored in the database. If I then would change bitarray in an incompatible way, which could include bumping the version number, but doesn't have to be, then the other package would be marked as broken by GHC package, could not be used, and would have to be recompiled. Yeah, I think there's an example. This depends on array and base, and it records the hashes there. So GHC package has, since last GHC release, a very tight grip on these dependencies. It doesn't break easily, as in binaries not running. But of course, we want our users to be able to, have inconsistent packages in the first place. So we need to take this logic that GHC package provides and lift it on the Debian package level. And we do this using virtual packages. So if you would package bitarray, then the tools that we use for building these packages takes this string and generates a virtual package that consists of libghc6, the cabal name, dash the type of package. We do this both for the dev and the prof package, dash version number, and then dash the first 5 digits of the hash. And then all depending packages get this in their depends and not the package name. Therefore, if I rebuild a package high up in the hierarchy and it changes the hash, people who have depending packages installed can't upgrade this package until the depending package has been rebuilt, which is good because Haskell packages installed from Debian are therefore always consistent. No, it's not. Yeah, let's fix it right away, because people might have heard a microsecond sleep. Therefore, we get the right thing here. Yeah, that looks better. Nothing we can fix in Debian. OK, the good thing is Haskell packages on Debian are always consistent. For our users, that's good. For us, it's bad because it reads a lot of rebuilds and binary news. I just uploaded a new GHG version 2 weeks ago, and we had to build 200-something source packages on all architectures. Luckily, since 2 years, we have support for BD uninstallable in Wonderbuild. That means that our build daemons won't try to install things that won't try to build things whose build dependencies can't be installed, which kind of fits very well with our scheme of these hash dependencies, because then Wonderbuild and the build daemons will automatically get the build order right. This would have been horrifying before that, and was basically Haskell was my motivation back then to implement that. So in a way, Haskell is a stress test for Debian infrastructure. Then for our users, it's a bit annoying because libraries are temporarily uninstallable. I build a new GHG package, and until all the libraries have been rebuilt that the user has installed, he cannot upgrade. But yeah, that could be it's a minor issue. Testing migration is hard because I have to get all the changed Haskell packages into testing at the same time. So I need to manually create a large hint file for those who are aware of how Brittany works. Plus, if the Haskell package is also part of another transition, things get complicated. So that if you have a if you want to see why packages are not testing and some Haskell packages involved, this is the reason. The good thing at least is that binaries are not affected. Haskell links statically, so that the binary that's being generated at the end has no dependency on anything Haskell related. It looks like a regular C build library, C build binary. So the binaries like git annex can migrate to testing and can be installed, even if Haskell packaging is currently in a bad shape. As long as we use static linking, since in last version GHG does provide dynamic linking, we're not using it yet. It's new and yeah, better be careful about that. But it has been discussed. Okay, let's package a Haskell library. Now I'm at this point. These are the resources, in case you want to look at it later again. And I'm going to do a live demonstration, as I have hinted before. Yes?
So you're saying the users of a Haskell program don't have these difficulties. So what you're doing is basically for Haskell developers who need all the libraries. Is that right? If everything's statically linked?
The users of, for example, git annex don't need to worry about Haskell at all. They don't see a single Haskell package on the machine.
It's simply binaries to them.
It's simply a binary to them.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Of course, Joey, as the developer of git annex, has problems if I break Haskell because his package won't build and he can't continue working on it. But yeah, it happens. Okay, packaging Haskell library, we have a wiki page of the group that lists a few things. We have a policy warning it's outdated. I think I've removed most of the outdated stuff without replacing it. If somebody likes putting common practice into wording and likes to fill up the policy, that would be very welcome. We have a tools repository that we'll use right in a moment, which has a template Debian directory, which we use as a starting point for packaging Haskell libraries. And there's a mailing list in our IRC channel. And yeah, the rest will be demonstrated. So as I said, we want to package BitArray. So we unpack it. This would download it and unpack it. Now we have the BitArray source file, the cabal file. You see here's the cabal file with the descriptions we've seen on the web page, including the dependencies. It depends on base and array, which is rather little. Other packages have much more dependencies. Okay, so we need a Debian directory. So we just copy the template directory, which I have conveniently lying around somewhere on my machine. And then I just go through all the files and fix what's left to fix. Of course, I always have to exchange foo by bit array. Then I set the version number. I don't have an ITP for this package, so I don't have anything to close. I know it's bad practice, but sometimes I'm lazy. And that's me. Then I go to the next file, which is compat file. Nothing to change here. Most of the work goes into the Debian rules control file. Who of you have seen the packaging for beginners talk in the morning? Okay, at least somebody knows what I'm doing. Again, I replace foo by bit array everywhere. I have to change the uploaders because we need to have real uploaders for some reason. And if you know that I'm doing all this in great detail just because I want to do the upload right away to make sure that you see some real work done, at this point, I would add all the dependencies on other Haskell packages. I would also look in the cabal file about their version range to encode this in the build dependencies. Now, this particular package doesn't have any dependencies that are not provided by the compiler, base and array are, so we can remove them. Some packages are bindings to C libraries. In that case, I have to have the corresponding developer package of the C library here. Not in this case, so I can remove this as well. Then home page is usually just the page of the package file, unless something better comes up. And we have the VCS fields for the team. Now, the binary package. The package name is, as I said before, libghsg-bitarray-dev. C libraries bindings need to have the dev package here again as a dependency, but not now. Then all the other fields are filled by our packaging tools. We've put as little as possible logic in the individual package and as much possible logic outside so that it's less work. Description. I can usually just get from package. Mutable and immutable bit arrays. And the long description would be, this package provides mutable and immutable bit arrays implemented as packed arrays of 64-bit integers, or words better. It provides a pure interface as well as monadic interfaces for the IO and ST monad. I think that's fair enough for this package. I have to copy. Thanks. Looks like we have Lintian sitting here. I have to copy this to all three files. I have all three packages that are provided by this source. And then there's a common blob that's below that explains the type of the package. And I also have to add this description, profiling data. And here, documentation. OK, am I done with the rules files? The prof package has nothing to change. The documentation package also nothing to change. So that was fairly easy. Then the control, the copyright file. Somebody suggests that we use the DEP5 format here. Not my choice, but I'm fine with it. Wait, upstream developer. Yeah. So let's copy that from here. And there's a license file in the code that I can copy here. Okay, I think this should be sufficient for the copyright file. Do I need to have the space dot here? Okay, let's add that as well. Good. This is the rules file, and we're a bit proud of that it can be this for almost all packages. And sorry, Joey, it's CDBS, historical reasons. This is the sources format directory. We use Quilt 3.0 source packages. And then this is also important. It's a watch file. We rely on it with our tools. But they are also always the same for all Haskell packages because they come from the same source. Did I forget anything, Gio? Did I forget anything about packaging? Okay. So this is my Debian file, Debian directory. So let's try to build it. Oh, I don't have an upstream file. But thanks to the watch file, I can just run uscan force download. And it'll put the file with the right name in the right directory. And we're good to go. Yeah, now we see some stuff running by. It's compiling. It's generating documentation. It's generating the packages. And CDBS thinks it has to run a lot of DH commands. And at the end, we have the three binaries available to use. So let's test them. I install it. It says trigger for GHC doc, which is the global index. It's being recalculated. And this warning will be gone away with the next upload of GHC. And once this finished, we can go to the system-wide index, and voila. CCCD data array, bit array, there it is. Locally installed with highlighted source available, because sometimes you need to read the sources of libraries to find out what they're doing. All very convenient, all very nice. And because this is such a fine package, I'm going to upload it right away. We use Darks as a version control system for our packages. I think I have to use Wasks by now. It works. I'm still confused about this migration. So I push the repository on darkstepping.org. At least I think so. It has connection because it's showing the fingerprints. Oh, good. And we also have to install a post commit hook that that makes sure we get commit messages. This is documented also on the wiki page for those who want to join development. Okay, this has been the initial push. We only have to do this once per package. Now I can mark the package for release. And yes, thanks. Build it again with the release tag. When I was practicing this, I ran the clean target, and now I forgot. So darks rec. Good. That looks better. Let's continue from here. And maybe I will fix the repository later. I'm building it again, and yes, thanks for my signed key. Okay, I have 4 IDs, 2 keys. Have you seen 8-pack mails by now? All right. I hope the video team doesn't have an angle on that. And then I always have deb commit, yes. I always have this command line to make sure that I don't forget to push my changes to the repository. So this being uploaded and pushed. And we have packaged and uploaded a new Haskell library for Debian. And I think it was pretty quick. So it's not a lot of work, but there's a lot of packages, so we always need help. And I can go back to the slides. At this point, I would like to express some wishes that I would like to have in Debian. I know some of them are difficult or maybe even not desired, but from our point of view, it would be great if you could bin NMU arch all packages, because some changes, sometimes we do changes and we don't have to change the 200 source packages, but we just have to rebuild everything. And doing this only by uploading a new Haskell dev script package and then NMU in everything would be really great. And similarly great, source-only uploads would be great. Sometimes we do changes where we are definitely sure it's not going to change anything problematic. For example, cleaning up the description files and having to rebuild 200 source packages just because of that, when the build IDs can find out how to rebuild what in what order, would be a great time saver. So that's a wish into the direction of Debian. In case some of you is going to be upstream for Debian for Haskell library, please write change logs. For some reason, it's not custom for upstream to write change logs, which is annoying. What we skipped today was everything about Haskell itself. But if you want to find more about that, there are good tutorials here, and I included them for those who would like to continue there. And you're free to ask me any questions during DebConf or within the next 8 minutes. Yeah, and the conclusion of this talk is Haskell for packaging Haskell for Debian is easy, is not difficult, but always needs more manpower. So you're welcome to join the Debian Haskell group if you want. We have a mailing list. We also have an IRC channel. I guess mailing list is more important and more active. And maybe as a last picture, I'm going to show this. That's the Haskell package dependency graph. And you can see why you don't want to build that manually in the right order. Okay, any questions at this point for the last 5 minutes? Joey?
Well, first of all, when you showed us the locally installed documentation for Haskell libraries, I looked at mine and I didn't see any because I hadn't installed the doc packages. And I also noticed when you installed your package, you had to install the doc package manually because nothing pulls it in. I'm wondering if you've thought about having a recommends in one direction or the other so we can only install one package and get the documentation too.
I think we have recommends, or at least suggests.
I checked and you don't. You have suggests.
Okay. So you would like to suggest documentation. So you're suggesting to change the suggest to recommends?
Well, in either the library package or in the documentation, I don't know which makes more sense. It might make more sense if you're installing the documentation, you probably also want the library. If you're installing the library, you may well not want the documentation.
That's fair enough, I think. Now, at this point, if you remember, the Debian control file had a recommends subscript, so we could change it in the central position and do bin removes of all arch all packages. Which we can't, so we will have to wait for the next time we actually have to rebuild them anyway to implement this. But I think it's a fair suggestion. If you want to file a bug against Haskell dev scripts, we won't forget it. There's one behind you.
Sorry.
Hiding.
I have a question about bootstrapping Haskell. New architecture in Debian. I think bootstrapping is very difficult. I think new architecture of Debian cannot success bootstrapping. If we, do you think so? This problem.
Sorry, I had problems understanding your questions. Can you repeat again? Oh, okay. Yeah, that's. I think it's difficult because Upstream says they have a certain set of architectures they care very much about, and everything else is second class. And of course, it's technically highly challenging because it does strange things like having a own calling conventions and very strange things happening on the heap. And but if anybody wants to do it, that would be great. What architecture are you considering? Is there any specific architecture you would like to see it on?
I'm not good at English. Please. Yes, I'm currently I'm porting a Super H is new architecture, and on and Debian ports. .org, PowerPC, SP, and Power and ARM hardware road porting now.
Okay. If somebody wants to do it, that's great. I don't know if we as the Haskell group which maintains THC is going to have the manpower and the skill set and the time to port to new architectures. But in a way, it's also Upstream work, so you're very welcome to talk to Upstream about that. And they take patches, it's just that they can't test it before they release, so things might break when they do a new version.
So I have a question. I apologize, I'm not a Haskell developer, but I'm curious, can we draw an analogy between Cabal and Maven?
If I would know Maven better, maybe.
So if you're not in Debian, if you're a typical non-Debian Haskell developer, do you use Cabal to just install all of your build depends? Is that how it works?
Yeah.
Okay, so it's similar to Maven. In the Java world, we struggle with this because a lot of Java developers just use Maven and they expect they'll pull down all their build dependencies, and it makes it tricky for us in Debian to tease that apart and package them appropriately. And so it's always interesting to me to see how other language libraries are handling that.
For us, it's pretty easy because the build dependencies are pulled in declarative. So there's this Cabal file, and maybe I would show some more complex Cabal file. Okay, maybe not because that's running out of time. And it's just listed them here. So at one time, we go through a list, we look at the corresponding Debian package name, put it in the controls file. At our upgrade, we check if the list has changed, we put them in, and everything works fine. So we have every reason to be happy about this particular part of the Haskell ecosystem.
Okay, one more question, if I may. Do you talk to Haskell packaging teams in other distributions and the problems they are facing?
The Ubuntu team, or Guy more or less, is part of our team. So basically, does the work in Debian and syncs it to Ubuntu. Very great. People should do them often. With other teams, no. There hasn't been any considerable collaboration. I think you can pass it back if you want to stretch the time a few seconds.
Your example of packaging a library, it looks fairly simple, but there is still a lot of boilerplate involved. I'm wondering if you have anything to automate generating the boilerplate or maintaining the boilerplate.
For maintaining it, we have the template directory. For generating, I think we stretched the generatability as far as we could by using substrars. Everything else would...
Well, I think that the Debian Perl team, for example, first of all, they can build a package out of CPAN directly, just heuristically. I wonder if you've thought about doing that with Hackage, and also I think they have something that can then maintain a package by updating the files as long as it's a file that their packaging tool knows about, say the format of the control file or the rules file or something like that.
For the first question, somebody is working on a tool to generate a Debian repository automatically from Hackage. Marcos is doing that. But of course, we don't want these packages in Debian directly. And for maintaining the files, so far we've been running fine. If we want to make a change across all packages, we run SED. Somebody writes a script. Keep it low-tech, keep it simple, and then people understand it.
I'm afraid we've run out of time. So please, again, thank Joachim Breitner for this interesting talk, and then we'll move on.